Subscribe to our channel and press the bell icon to never miss an update.
I had to leave for my center at 6 o'clock in the morning and I could not sleep at night. So I didn't know what to do. I kept tossing and turning. I was a little tense at that point of time. So I got up at 1 in the night and I started solving the previous year's CAT paper. Back when I passed my 12th grade, the system had changed a little bit, the JEE system, the way they took people in for engineering batches had changed. And I got to know about this new course, architecture, which had a different paper. And it really excited me, so I decided to go for it and I even got a college of my choice. So I went for it. The 5 years in architecture was nothing like what I'd imagined. It was something that could not be taught in a classroom program. It was more of a live experience. We got to go on city tours. We got to experience architecture in its physical form. We went on trips. We designed hospitals. We renovated old structures. So it really gave me a very different perspective on how things could be designed. Basically, I realized I wanted to do marketing, either digital or real life. Marketing really interested me. Why? Because even as architects, you understand people's needs, you design something according to their needs, right? That is what marketing basically is. So I decided I wanted to do marketing, plus I didn't really like the prospects that architecture gave me after my undergrad. After researching a little bit, I realized that MBA had a lot more scope than what architecture gave me. So it was just one shot that I wanted to give to MBA and actually see what I was capable of and if I could actually do it. So initially, obviously, my scores were not good. They were disappointing. I started with a 94 percentile, the first mock that I gave. Started with a 94 percentile, which was solely because of my VARC scores. The quant and the DILR was still giving me a very tough time. I was close to 60-70 percentiles in those. Quant was still understandable because I wasn't done with the course. So as time progressed, I started getting better scores, albeit not what I wanted, but better scores. But DILR was still creating a huge issue for me because I was still stuck at the 70s in DILR. So I realized that what needed to be done in DILR was that you needed incessant practicing. That is all you can do about DILR because basically everything around you could be a logical reasoning test, right? July, August was only brushing up on quant and brushing up on my basic concepts and even understanding what different kinds of problems that we get. For example, even VARC is not just basic VARC we used to get earlier. It has a lot of critical reasoning to it. So majority of emphasis I laid on critical reasoning, understanding the critical reasoning, because that is what your entire verbal revolved around. So 2 months I had dedicated entirely to brushing up my concepts and strengthening my concepts. Starting September, I started taking more mocks, like once a week. Once a week was good enough for me. And then I started taking sectionals. Since I was done with the course, I need to get back on my speed. I needed to achieve a speed that I could do a decent number of questions in the given time. When I started doing my quant, I realized that what I'd learned up until now, it only allowed me, so quant has 34 questions, I could only do like 20-22 questions up until then, and the accuracy wasn't very good. So I realized a lot needed to be done there. I started actually not using shortcuts, but going by the basics, because what I've realized even in the last CAT 2018 paper, was that there was no direct question that required you to use a shortcut. It was a blend of 3 different topics and you needed to know your basics to actually get it right. So I tried going by the basics and going by the basic definition of a concept to actually arrive at the solution, which worked wonders because when you know the concept, there's no question you actually cannot do. So that actually started giving me a little bit of speed and confidence. My accuracy got better, definitely. The next big problem was my VARC accuracy. I had good speed in VARC, I could attempt all 34 questions, but with like a 60% accuracy, so that was no good. So I realized a lot needed to be done there. I started with the RCs, the reading comprehensions, and there I started spending a little more time on reading the RCs than on the questions. So earlier what I used to do was I used to brush through the RC and then go to the questions and then I'd have to come back to the RC. What I started doing was I started spending more time understanding what the RC meant, tried to imply. So once you do that, you don't really need to go back to the RC to answer every question that follows. 4 out of 6 questions are easily answerable when you do that. So that majorly increased my accuracy in VRC. And the para jumbles took a little bit while, but I think it's all practice for para jumbles. Next, when it came to DILR, the one thing that I realized there is it all depends on how you select your sets there. So you have 8 sets, 4 each. So if you just go by the first set you see, then you're going to end up getting stuck at something that is never getting solved in those, you know, 1 hour. So I took 5 to 10 minutes initially to actually figure out which were the doable ones and which were the ones that I would want to attend next. So I started selecting sets in such a manner that the first 3 to 4 sets could be done in like 45 minutes. And then I could spend the next 15 minutes trying to get an extra set in. So that started turning out a little well. It took a little while to understand what I was comfortable with, the kind of sets. And then eventually you find your pick. You find your pick and you find what you're comfortable with. So that is how I ended on DALR. The last 1 month was all taking mocks, taking incessant mocks. It was almost one or two mocks every day. I took up the test series from all the three major systems that we have, CL, Time and IMS. So every day we used to have one or the other test. So that actually gave me a different perspective, because if you just take tests from one series, it's a set pattern, because there's just one or two people who design the test. So it's a set pattern there. You need to understand the different kinds of patterns that there are. So I took up the other two test series as well, and you know, at certain places the quant was tougher, at certain places the DALR was different. So it got me used to that. I got into the blend of that. The last 3 to 4 days before CAT, I actually took a break. I took no mocks. I got back to solving the previous year's papers. The previous year's papers had a different blend again, but it actually gave me confidence of whether I could take the actual paper or not. And then the last day I pretty much did nothing. The day before the CAT paper, I was nervous, but surprisingly not very nervous, which actually scared me. Why? But I pretty much slept through the entire day. I had nothing to do and I had to leave for my center at 6 o'clock in the morning, and I could not sleep at night. So I didn't know what to do. I kept tossing and turning. I was a little tense at that point of time. So I got up at 1 in the night and I started solving the previous year's CAT paper, to actually, which would give me a little bit of confidence if I could actually do it. I solved the quant of that paper at 1 in the night. It was easier than this year's quant, is what I can tell you. It was easier and I was like, oh, you know, quant is gonna happen. And I just slept. I tried to sleep. I got like 3 hours of sleep that night. And then I woke up. The center was a little far. It was like 30 kilometers from my place. So I went there. I was not very nervous, and that scares me, because when I'm not very nervous, it actually turns out not good for me. So I have to be nervous. But I got really tense, but then I was like, okay, let's just go with it. It didn't really give me much time to think, because as soon as I got there, I had to deposit my things and I had to go through the security check and I had to go inside. So when I actually got to my system, we had like 30 minutes before the paper started, and that was when it all hit me. And I started panicking a little. I didn't know what to do. So I just relaxed. I tried to breathe. I tried to realize that I have studied for it and it'll just happen the way it's supposed to be. You can't do anything about it, right? So when the paper started, the VRC section. So there's things that you don't anticipate that happen around you. So I'm sitting here trying to study. There's this fan that's going around that's making a lot of noise. You can't concentrate. There's this girl sitting right next to you who's speaking very loudly and reading everything. You can't concentrate. You don't know what to do. Then I legit had to close my ears and try to read and try to take it all in. So usually when in my mocks, when I used to do my quant, when I used to do my VRC, I used to really have like 5 minutes left at the end of it to go through everything. But the day of the paper, I was left with not 1 second. At the last moment, I had to answer a question and I was not confident why that happened. So that gave me a little bit of jitter. After that, the DILR section. The DILR section, from what I'd heard in the previous year, that was very difficult. But comparatively, I found it easier, though I could not attend a lot of questions. But I attended a substantial amount of questions. So DILR was still breathable after what happened in VRC. I attempted 5 sets. 5 sets in DILR. And with a decent accuracy, so that worked out well for me. I mostly focus on accuracy more than attempting questions. So there was that. And then the major part hit, which was quant. So I started with quant. So I used to do quant in like 3 phases, right? First, you go through every question that you see. You keep attempting whichever ones you find easy. And after the first phase, you go on the ones that you've marked for review and you know, but will take a little bit of time. The first run that I did, it barely gave me what, like 5 to 7 questions. And I was scared. I could not get anything else. I didn't expect quant to be that tough. I just couldn't understand what happened. I went through the second run. I started spending time. I kept looking at the timer. The time was running out. I didn't know what to do. I kept attempting. Again, there was a blend of different concepts. So my basic concepts that were clear came a lot handy. I kept attempting questions, so before you know, the time is over, right? You're just going through it and the time is over. I still had like a few questions left for review, but I could not really go back to them. So after, at the end of it, I saw that I had attempted 25 or 26 questions in quant, which was not very good from what I'd been doing. I'd been attending 30 plus in my mocks by the end of it. So I was not really sure what had happened. I was very, very disappointed. So we start walking out of the place, and then I start hearing buzz about quant. So I'm like, okay, quant was tough. People are saying quant was tough. I'm still not satisfied with my performance. Then I hear people who are actually attempting good number of questions. They're like, they attempted 16, they're attempting 17. So I was like, okay, that's, you know, 26 maybe is still a decent number. So then by the end of the day, we start getting reviews of the paper, and that is when I realized, okay, quant was really tough. So 26 was a decent number of questions. So it's just, it's, you cannot anticipate what happens in there. You have to go with the paper. There's a different kind of paper every year. You just have to improvise at the point. When I calculated my scores, I was surprised. I honestly did not expect that huge a score. I was expecting a decent, number, but my accuracy was beyond what I have had in any mock. So this is my second highest score ever, including mocks. So I got a 205 in my score that I calculated, and I was anticipating a 99.9 plus, because considering the other scores that people were putting up on different platforms, I saw 99.9 plus was expected. 99.96 was exceeding my expectations, definitely. Prior to taking CAT, I was hoping for a 99.5 plus. So 99.9 plus was definitely amazing for me. In my VARC, I had 99.69. In my DILR, 99.5. And in my quant, I had 99.89. So quant really did the work for me. I had calls from all of the IIMs except for IIM Bangalore, and I applied to all of the institutes that there are, including SNAP, ZAT, TIS, everything. So I didn't know what would work for me. So when I got the calls, I got calls from every interview that I applied to, every institute, except for IIM Bangalore. My IIM Ahmedabad interview was in February, and it was in Delhi. So the interview was fairly short. First, we had the AWT section, which is the analytical writing test. After that, we were called in for the interviews. The interview was like, 15 minutes, I think, max. It was a fairly casual interview. It was a casual exchange conversation. I was asked about my undergrad, since I didn't have a work ex. I was asked about my undergrad. I was asked about how the architecture of IIM Ahmedabad is, the campus which is famous for its building. So I was asked about that. I was asked about Jaipur, where I come from, the different kinds of architecture. I was asked about why would I want to pursue. So it was a fairly casual conversation, which you could not really judge how it went. My Calcutta interview, on the other hand, was quite grilling. They grilled me a lot on my school subjects a little bit, since I had a little Olympiad scores in there. So they started asking me questions from 10th class physics, which I obviously did not remember. They grilled me a little bit on things that they expected. So architecture basically is a very vast topic which not a lot of people know what it constitutes of. Like, even I would not anticipate what the course constituted of. So they expect you to know everything about architecture, which I tried to read up, but I could not really totally do it before the interviews. There were a few questions I could not answer. There were a few questions. So basically, design thinking comes up a lot when you talk about architecture. The FMS interview, yeah, it was the last one. It was the last of the leg. And we first had the GD. We had the GD for like 10 minutes, which went well. I started the GD. It went all right. Then I went in for the interview. So there's a small extempore that they have. I was given the topic Kingfisher for that. You have to speak for a minute on the topic. I preferred speaking on the bird rather than the, beverage brand that we all know of, because since, you know, it's all a little down right now. So that went all right. After that, the major question that comes up when you try to pursue MBA after a very different field is, why would you switch? So it takes a little while trying to convince people that you actually want to switch. And after that, I was given a few real life situations of how I would go about implementing the green architecture in buildings, how I would go around making sure that people went green in their building techniques. It was a 10-minute interview, barely a 10-minute interview, small interview. And that, as in my opinion, was the best interview that went for me.